Okay, this will be your lecture on urinary and renal disorders. First, I want to begin with anatomy review. So, we should all know at this point in 202 that we have two kidneys. The kidneys are about 5 inches in length, so that's about the length of our hand. If you measure from the palm to the end of your middle finger, that's about five inches. And the kidneys weigh about 4 to 6 ounces, so maybe a little bit less than a can of Coke or soda. When we talk about some of the structures of the kidney, some of the larger structures that we can actually visualize and that we see in pictures, you have the adrenal medulla, and we learned about that on last semester. The adrenal medulla lies on the top of each kidney, and we know that it's responsible for some of our endocrine functions. And we have the adrenal cortex, which is the outer layer, and then the adrenal medulla, which is the inner layer, which is the inner layer of the kidneys. We have minor and major calyces, and so the purpose of the calyces is that the minor calyces merge together and they widen to form what we call the renal pelvis. That's important to know because the renal pelvis is responsible for draining urine from the kidneys to the ureters. The renal pelvis of each kidney can only store a small amount of urine, about 3 to 5 mL. So we also have microstructures of the kidneys, and those are the really important structures. We have the nephron of the kidney, and the nephron is the functional unit of the kidney. Each kidney has about 1 million nephrons, so we have a lot of nephrons. Each nephron is composed of a glomerulus, your Bowman's capsule, and also we have a tubular system within the nephron of the kidney. And the tubular system includes our proximal convoluted tubule, your loop of Henle, your distal convoluted tubule, and then your collecting tubules. So why do you need to know all of that? Well, because the different segments of the nephron serve different purposes. And when we talk about the absorption and filtration properties of the kidney, those take place in the smaller units of the kidneys or within the nephron. And so an example is that with the proximal tubule, it's responsible for the reabsorption of 80% of our electrolytes. And then the proximal tubule is also responsible for the reabsorption of bicarbonate. And so that's important when we have acid-base issues. We need a functioning kidney to be able to either release or reabsorb bicarb, depending on the problem. We have the loop of Henle, which is responsible for the reabsorption of sodium and chloride, and it also reabsorbs water as well. And then we have the distal tubule, which is responsible for the secretion of potassium ions or hydrogen ions. We know those play a big part in our acid-base balance. Then it's also responsible for reabsorbing bicarb. It's also responsible for regulating our parathyroid hormone, our sodium, our potassium, and it does that through regulating aldosterone. And so those small parts of our kidneys play a really big part in our day-to-day functioning as far as controlling or managing our electrolyte levels, our acid-base balance, our fluid balance. The smaller units in the kidney are responsible for regulating that. Our ureters on the ends of each kidney, and just kind of look at the picture that we have here, connected to each kidney you have a ureter, and so the ureter connects at the renal pelvis, and so you have both ureters here connected at the renal pelvis, and so they extend downward and connect to the bladder. And so when we talk about the ureters, their purpose, again, is to carry urine from the renal pelvis to the bladder. And so what we have to remember, what's important for us to remember about the ureters is that ureters are kind of like those valves we learned about in the heart. They're only supposed to allow one-way flow. The ureters also have contraction properties or contractive properties, which means that they're able to move urine from the kidneys to the bladder via contraction, being able to contract. What happens in situations such as hydronephrosis, which we've talked about before and which you'll also read, with hydronephrosis and when the person has, not nephrosis, but hydroureter, the person has water that backs up into the ureters, and so when that happens, it causes the ureters to become distended, and once those muscles become distended, it affects their properties to perform that muscular contraction. So once that happens, then we have those problems such as the hydronephrosis that we'll talk about. Okay, so we have a bladder, and so as I said here, both ureters will connect to the left and right side of the bladder, and the bladder is positioned right beneath our symphysis pubis. So we should know where the symphysis pubis is. And so normal urine output, this is a review, should be about 15 mils per day. And so we said the bare minimum is going to be 30 cc's per hour. And so that 15 mils a day when we talk about urine output is definitely going to depend on the person's food and fluid intake. And so, and then we also have some hormonal influences that will affect our urine output. And that hormonal, that hormone is ADH, our antidiuretic hormone. On average, when our urine fills with about maybe 2 to 250 cc's of urine, this is what causes the bladder to become moderately distended, and that's when we have the urge to urinate. Now, when that quantity reaches about 400 to 600, that's when we start to feel a little uncomfortable and a little fidgety. The last thing we will discuss as far as our anatomy review is the urethra. And so the urethra, this is a small tube that leads from the bladder neck to the external meatus. And so we know that the female urethra, we remember this from fundamentals, the female urethra is about one to two inches long. It lies behind the symphysis pubis, but the male urethra is about 8 to 10 inches long. And so when we talk about urinary tract infections a little bit later coming up, we can kind of understand, we can see why females are more susceptible to urinary tract infections because of the shorter length of our urethras. Okay, so again, just a little picture diagram in the kidneys, the ureters, the bladder, and then you can barely see it, but the urethra is down there at the bottom. And so as I mentioned, the hormonal influence of the nephrons function, and it's basically responsible for controlling the release of antidiuretic hormone, and that is regulated by the distal tubule, which is a part of the nephron. And so again, antidiuretic hormone is going to be released in those times where we've lost fluid, and so it's going to be released in an attempt to withstand or in an attempt to up our fluid volume. So if we're losing fluid, antidiuretic hormone is going to be released so that we're maintaining our fluid volume. And so some things that cause antidiuretic hormone to be released, as you see here, can be released in response to hemorrhage, low blood volume, low blood pressure. A person has diaphoresis, they're sweating, vomiting, diarrhea. The commonality between all these things is that we've lost fluid. And so when antidiuretic hormone is released, it's going to cause us to retain fluid, and then it's going to cause a rise in our blood pressure. So that's good if we're in shock. It's good if we're dehydrated. It's not good day to day when we're stressed and it affects our blood pressure. So it's, you know, protective in nature, but antidiuretic hormone, when it's released at the wrong times, can also be harmful as well. And so, again, this is a review, but the function of the kidneys, of course, it's responsible for urine formation. And so we know that there are that urine formation is a system of filtration and diffusion. So you can go back through that, but remember that our normal glomerular filtration rate is 125 mils per minute. And so what the glomerular filtration rate is, it's the amount of blood filtered each minute by the glomerulus, about each of our glomeruli. So again, that's going to be about 125 mils per minute. It's responsible for fluid and electrolyte balance. We talked about that. The kidneys are responsible for reabsorbing what we need and excreting what we don't. And so it's responsible for that reabsorption of sodium. We lose potassium, and that's the purpose of aldosterone. And so we also learned about it's the part that it plays in bicarbonate, the reabsorption or the release of bicarbonate. Also, again, it's going to be responsible for the excretion of waste, okay? Blood pressure regulation, we know that the kidneys are responsible for releasing renin, which causes the release of your angiotensin 1, your angiotensin 2. It also releases some aldosterone in there and causes vasoconstriction, which subsequently causes the blood pressure to increase. When we have when the body senses that our oxygen levels are low, erythropoietin can be secreted, and so red blood cells are produced as a result of the secretion of erythropoietin, and that is released by the kidneys. And kidneys are also responsible for the activation of vitamin D. So when we're doing a health history on our patient and they're coming in and they're talking about maybe having some problems with the urinary system, these are the different areas we want to ask them about. We want to ask them about any changes in the color. Is the urine darker? Is the urine concentrated? How much urine? When we talk about the male with BPH, we learned that he'll have small amounts of urine. Well, when you learned about renal failure, we know that when the person is in the different phases of acute kidney injury, they can have small amounts of urine, then large amounts of urine. So we want to know how much urine. Is the person going a couple of times a day, or are they constantly in the restroom? Does the person have a difficulty initiating stream, starting it? Does it take a long time to start it? Okay, we want to know about frequency. Is it painful for the person to urinate? We definitely want to know about hematuria, because hematuria can be harmless, or it can be one of those late signs of prostate cancer. Okay, so we want to know about that. We want to know about any problems with urgency, nocturia, oliguria, any polyuria, large amounts of urine. And we know that we definitely see that with our diabetic patients. And flank pain, that's that pain that's around the back, around the sides. And we know that if a person is complaining of flank pain, well, then it's probably something going on with the kidneys themselves. So those are some different areas we'd like to hit. When we talk in terms of our laboratory findings, these are some different labs that can be drawn when we have patients coming in complaining of problems, with suspected problems with the urinary or renal system. A urinalysis is going to be our most common urinary study. They're easy to obtain. You have the person go in, we give them a little cup, and we go in and tell them, you know, give me about half a cup. When we're working with patients in the hospital, if we need a urinalysis and the person has a Foley, we take it straight from the Foley bag. And so the urinalysis, we're looking at the urinalysis to determine if there's any blood, any protein, glucose, ketones, determining the pH, specific gravity, and noting the color. Now, when we talk about a urine culture and sensitivity, we can't just simply take a urine from a Foley bag or have a person to give us urine without cleansing the perineum, cleansing the perineum well before they obtain that sample. a culture insensitivity, we're trying to determine if the person has a bacteria. And so we need to not let our instrumentation or our technique of getting that urine affect the results that we receive. So when we're obtaining a urine culture from a person that has a Foley catheter, if you remember this, we take the tube, that clear tube that we actually see the urine in, you take that, you clamp that off much like a water hose, put your rubber band around it, and then you go up to your port, go up to the port that's on the catheter, we swab that with alcohol, take a needle, and we pull the cleanest part of the urine. And so at that point, when we go up to that collection port, this is the part that's coming directly from the bladder. So we want the cleanest part of that urine. Again, if the person is alert and oriented and ambulatory, no Foley catheter, we have them have a woman definitely to wipe front to back, and we have a male to clean that urinary meatus really good. And then we want the cleanest part of the urine, calling the clean catch urine, have them express a couple of cc's of urine, and then we catch the middle part of that urine. So when we're doing culture insensitivities, again, we're doing that to determine specific microorganisms. The blood urea nitrogen is going to be important because it's going to indicate the kidney's ability to excrete urea. Your serum creatinine, it's going to be important because it indicates the kidney's ability to excrete waste. And so, as it says down here, your serum creatinine is going to be a better measure of kidney function than your BUN. And the reason that is that we excrete creatinine on a daily basis. Creatinine is a breakdown of our muscle. So every time we move, every move we make, we lose small muscle cells. And so every time we urinate, we're losing muscle cells through our urine. And so the thought is that since this is something that continuously happens every day, then that's going to be a more specific measurement. BUN is blood urea nitrogen, and so there are different things that can affect our nitrogen level, such as how much protein we're taking in, if we're not eating enough meats, and we're not doing the right pairing with our vegetables to get those essential or those complete amino acids, it's going to affect our nitrogen levels. And so BUN, both of them are good, but serum creatinine is going to be a better measure of function of our BUN. And then we have our urine-specific gravity, and urine-specific gravity measures the concentration of the urine. And so our normal range for urine-specific gravity is 1.005 to 1.030. We have some diagnostic tests that can be performed when we have patients and we suspect that there are some abnormalities going on. We can have different diagnostic tests. And so one of those exams is the kidney ureter bladder exam. And so it's also in the hospital, you'll hear it being referred to as a KUB. And so a KUB, as it says here, is going to look at those structures, the kidneys, the ureters, and the bladder. It's looking at the size, the structure, the position. It can also help determine if the person has stones or any foreign bodies during the KUB. With the intravenous pyelogram, these are done to visualize the urinary tract after the person has IV contrast media injected. So of course we have to definitely assess for any allergies before this exam is done. But again, it's going to also determine the presence, the position, the size, the shape of the kidneys, the ureters, the bladder. It's also going to outline any cysts or tumors, any types of lesions, obstructions. Any type of distortions from normal can be determined with the intravenous pyelogram. And so what has to be done before a person can have an intravenous pyelogram? We have to assess the person's renal function before doing one of these, because the contrast medium that is used for this can worsen the person's renal function. So a person has to have adequate renal function before having an IVP performed. So what that means is that we've got to do what a BUN and a creatinine before they can have this procedure done. So as I say, it's here, usually the person is going to be MPO 8 hours before the test. The evening before this test, we usually give the person enemas to empty the colon of any extra feces or gas, because if we have a full abdomen, it can distort the pictures that we're going to see. We want to advise the person during this procedure that it's normal to feel a little flushed, and they may sense a salty taste as the the person may sense a salty taste when the contrast medium is being administered. So just let them know that is normal, and that this is not an abnormality. And this is just showing you an example of what happens with the IVP, that it's an IV injection, okay, the intravenous injection, and then it just highlights those different structures. Another diagnostic exam that can be performed is a cystoscopy. So a cystoscopy is an endoscopic examination of the bladder. Again, it can also provide direct visualization of the urethra, the bladder, the urethral orifices. It's done under local anesthesia and sedation. So the purpose of a cystoscopy, you see it here, it's done to, you know, biopsy lesions, remove small bladder tumors. Stones can be removed from the bladder, from the ureters, and also dilation of the ureters can be done if the ureters have become stenosed. And when we have patients that are about to receive a cystoscopy, we're going to either force fluids or give them IV fluids. We have to make sure that we give a consent. We have to have consent before this procedure is done. Usually when the person is to receive a cystoscopy, the person is going to be placed in a lithotomy position. So why is this important? This is important if you have a person with COPD or some type of respiratory issue that can't tolerate lying on their back for extended periods of time. You know, the people that have to sit up in chairs or lean over bedside tables to breathe, they're not going to be able to tolerate this procedure. And so that's important to remember, that we're using the lithotomy position with this. Complications that can occur as a result of having a cystoscopy: the person can have some urinary retention, urinary tract hemorrhage, bladder infections, and the person can also have perforation of the bladder. So there are definitely some side effects, some risk to having this procedure done. So in the postoperative period after this procedure, we want to explain to the person that it's normal to have some burning on urination, and that the urine in the immediate postoperative period is going to be pink tinged. The person may have some urinary frequency in this period. We want to observe, though, for bright red bleeding. This is not normal. This may mean that the person has a urinary tract hemorrhage. So we definitely want to monitor for bright red bleeding. We don't allow this person to walk alone after the procedure. The person could have some orthostatic hypertension. The person, we could offer some, maybe a sitz bath, some heat to assist with any discomfort after this procedure is performed. The renal angiogram. The renal angiogram is another procedure that's done that evaluates blood supply to the kidneys, and it can also determine the presence of masses, any complications that may have occurred after a kidney transplant. When a person is to have a renal angiogram, as it says here, we want the person to be MPO after midnight. The person is going to receive an enema the night before. With this person, we're going to be injecting dye, so we want to determine if the person has an iodine sensitivity. And again, much like the other exam, whenever we're using contrast, let the person know that they're going to feel a warm sensation when the contrast media is injected. After this procedure, we're going to place the place a pressure dressing over the femoral artery because this is the area of insertion. We're going to observe this site for bleeding definitely, and we're going to have this person to maintain bed rest with the affected leg straight. We want to make sure that we're always assessing peripheral pulses of the involved leg every 30 to 60 minutes to detect if there's any occlusion to blood flow that could possibly be caused by a thrombus. When a person has a renal angiogram done, it can help differentiate between a renal cyst or a renal tumor. And so remember, our tumors tend to be solid and our cysts tend to be fluid filled. So renal angiograms are helpful in that they can help distinguish between a cyst and a tumor. With our renal venogram, a renal venogram is going to be, it's a diagnostic procedure that is done, and these provide information about the circulatory health of the kidneys. The renal venogram is kind of like the other exams that we talked about. It uses the radiopaque catheter and the injected dye as well. But with this procedure, it's done to visualize the veins within the kidneys and the veins carrying blood away from the kidneys. So to determine the health of those veins within the kidneys and the veins outside of the kidneys. So kind of, you know, the same way with the other ones, we want to instruct them, ask about any allergies. We've got that by now. Again, we're using a catheter inserted in the femoral site after this one. So again, it's going to be important for that person to lie with that leg straight. We've got to apply pressure definitely. When the person is having this procedure done, and remember this, anytime we're using a contrast medium, that if the person is taking glucophage is one of those, it's a diabetic medication, and glucophage and contrast medium don't get along. And so if we have a person and they take glucophage with a contrast medium, it's going to hurt the kidneys. It's going to cause some kidney damage. And so we have the person to stop that, to not take that glucophage the day of the procedure. When a person is having this procedure, they are at risk for some hemorrhage if one of the veins or one of the blood vessels is punctured. The person can develop some infection. They can develop kidney failure from having this. And we just have to be cautious of that anytime we have a person receiving any type of dye. We have to check our lab values before this procedure. Maybe the doctor didn't catch it. And so we want to make sure that we let them know of any lab values that are out of normal, your BUN and your creatinine. And as I mentioned, that make sure that you know the normals on your BUN, your creatinine. You make sure you go over your lab values. And a renal biopsy. We've kind of talked about biopsies a lot, and so we know that the biopsy is done because it's going to tell us definitively if a person has cancer. And so with a renal biopsy or a kidney biopsy, they're taking small pieces and viewing it under a microscope to determine if the person actually has a cancer. It can be used utilized to help stage the cancer. And so a person can have an open surgical biopsy, which is an open surgical procedure, or a person can have what is called a needle biopsy. So first we're going to begin with talking about cystitis. Cystitis is inflammation of the bladder. The thing about it is when you're beginning to do your reading and we talk about urinary tract infections. That's just one of those terms, I think, that's just been used synonymously all of these years. The urinary tract is the urethra, it's the bladder, it's the ureters, it's the kidney. And sometimes a person may have a bladder infection that is just affecting that bladder. And so really that's cystitis, and that's not a urinary tract infection. And so I'm saying that to say, you may read in different places when a person says cystitis, they're calling it a urinary tract infection when it's actually a bladder infection. So there is a difference. But if a person has cystitis, if a person has infection of the bladder, it can move up the urinary tract. So an infection that begins in the urethra and the bladder can move up, it can progress, it can migrate and move up to the kidneys and cause actual infection with the kidney. And so some issues, it says here that people that have catheters in the hospital are at high risk for developing nosocomial cystitis. So we know nosocomial means that they didn't come to the hospital with it. So what we have to do, since we know that this is one of the major reasons that patients develop cystitis, is we have to make sure that we're performing catheter care. That is done on a daily basis whenever a person is receiving their AM care. We're taking some type of antiseptic device and we're cleaning the length of that catheter from the meatal opening, and cleaning the length of that catheter. We know throughout the day with the people lying in bed, the catheter can migrate. If we don't have our stat locks on, the catheters can migrate back and forth, and it's pulling in those dead skin cells, any debris that was on the sheets. That stuff is being pulled back into the person's bladder and can cause cystitis. So we want to make sure that we're changing sheets, definitely, and performing catheter care. When a person has urinary tract infections, usually they complain of painful urination, frequent urination. They may have problems with increased urge to urinate. And so the way that we determine what's going on with the person and what they're growing, we have to do a urine culture, because there are different little culprits out there that can cause these infections. E. coli is the one that we see most often. That's the more common bacteria that we see, but that's only one. There are other bacteria that can grow in the bladder. Staphylococcus is one, Klebsiella. So again, that's why we have to do a urine culture to determine what the bacteria is, and then we can order the person antibiotics to treat this. Definitely when we have this person with cystitis, I would think it would be important to make sure that the person drinks plenty of water to help flush that urine out. We can see, as I said, I mentioned Foley catheters. Sometimes women can develop urinary tract infections as a result of sexual intercourse. And so just a number of different reasons. Not cleaning appropriately. You'll be surprised, but not all women know that you're supposed to wipe from front to back. And so when they don't know that, well, then you have a person that's introducing bacteria into the urethra. And so then they develop some cystitis as a result of that. So as you see here again, that frequency, that dysuria, urgency, we're going to do a urinalysis to determine a culture, determine what the bacteria is, and then order antibiotics if possible. Rarely a person can have a urinary a cystitis that's caused by viruses or fungi. So it's usually bacteria, but there can be other culprits that cause this cystitis to occur. Urethritis is inflammation of the urethra, And so it's one of the more common, the most common symptom that we see with urethritis is painful or difficult urination. We can sometimes see urethritis being related to some STDs. Gonorrhea can cause a person to have some urethritis. Chlamydia can cause urethritis. There are different bacteria, E. coli again, trichomonas, different strep disorders can cause a person to develop urethritis. In women, we sometimes see urethritis being caused as a result of pelvic inflammatory disease. When a person has urethritis, one other thing that I wanted to mention, we can see this sometimes in women when we're using different types of, lotions and perfumes and sprays and, your bubble baths and things that you may use. Sometimes spermicides and contraceptives can cause urethritis to occur. There are a number of medications that can be used for urethritis. Again, the person would have to have some cultures done to determine, what bacteria the person is growing. We definitely want to stress for this person perineal hygiene. That is going to be very important. During this time, definitely avoiding any type of vaginal deodorant sprays like your, forgot the name of it, but the different deodorant sprays, hygiene deodorant sprays, definitely want to not use those. A person would want to avoid intercourse during this time as well. Once a woman goes through menopause our body stop producing estrogen, one of the side effects that can occur is vaginal dryness and itching, and those two can lead to urethritis and cystitis. So some women may have some estrogen replacements that help with this. And so one way of figuring this out, if you have a woman who begins to experience these symptoms after menopause, well, then we know that it's related to her estrogen. And so there are different types of creams that can be used, estrogen creams that can be used. Some women will use estrogen replacement. Some women are afraid of estrogen replacement because estrogen increases risk of breast cancer. It helps with some things. It helps decrease your risk of osteoporosis, increase your risk of breast cancer, and ovarian cancer. So urethritis is something else that can be caused, something that can be caused as a result of that lack of estrogen. So when we talk about urethral stricture, that definitely sounds like that's going to be a little painful because, well, the urethra is how we get rid of urine. So when we have a person that has urethral strictures, as it says here, the most common symptom that we see with a urethral stricture is that the person is going to have an obstruction of blood flow. Well, that just makes sense. And the narrowing of the urethra can be caused by a number of different reasons. Urethritis, which we just talked about, can cause some scarring to occur, and a person can develop a urethral stricture as a result of that chronic inflammation from urethritis. Different injuries, instrumentation, people that that constantly have to be catheterized can develop urethral strictures. And so the hallmark, the key signs of a urethral stricture is a person having a weak urinary stream. Other things that the person may see is that the urine sprays or splays out, just kind of like all over the place. It's not a steady stream, one stream. It's all over the place. The person may have some frequency, urgency, straining to urinate, pain during urination. Because of this, this person is going to be at increased risk for urinary tract infections. If it's a man, he can develop some prostatitis. And it makes sense then, with the urethral stricture, that the person can develop some problems with completely emptying the bladder. And so if a person develops a severe urethral stricture, then they're going to completely lose the ability to urinate. And so this is a medical emergency, okay, because this definitely is going can lead to hydronephrosis and then some renal failure. So the surgical treatment, as it says here, that can be done is a urethroplasty. And so a temporary measure that can be done for that, as it says here, is that a person can have dilation of the urethra, a person can have a urethral stent, a person can have a urethroplasty. And so a urethroplasty refers to an open reconstruction of the urethra. And so the success rate is about 85% to 95% with the urethroplasty. With the stent, a stent is where it's like a little mesh or kind of like a bulbar material that is inserted in the urethra to help expand it or help open it. In the emergency situation, that's where we may see that urethra dilation take place. And it can be done in an emergency department, in the practitioner's office. The advantage of this approach is that the urethra may remain open, but it's going to stay open for a short period of time. So this is not a long-term cure for urethral stricture. The person, if this continues to happen, the person may have to have a suprapubic catheter inserted. We know if it's a stricture, if the person maybe has some scar tissue or some adhesions that occurred in the urethra, then we're not going to be able to insert a catheter through that urethra. So the person may have to have a suprapubic catheter placed in a situation that they are not able to treat the urethral stricture. Once it's fixed, the person can have a failure rate with even with them doing the dilation procedures or the stents. Now, urolithiasis is the presence of calculi stones in the urinary tract. So, as you see here, we have some we have a number of different reasons that people can develop stones. We have calculi stones, what it just says here. When the urine becomes more alkaline in nature, then it can cause a person to develop stones. Sometimes people develop uric acid stones. People that eat a lot of meat can develop uric acid stones. And so one thing that's important for us to remember is to make sure that we're drinking enough water to help ourselves and our family members, well, not to develop these stones. If you're a person that likes to drink a lot of sodas cause our urine to become more alkaline. And when you say, well, soda is kind of fizzy, it seems like it'd be more acidic. Well, it actually causes our urine to become more alkaline in nature. And so, again, urolithiasis, this is when a person has kidney stones. So, again, most urinary stones are composed of calcium oxalate. We see kidney stones developing in men most often. Women can develop stones as well, but we tend to see them happen a lot in men. So when we talk about a kidney stone, it says stones in the urinary tract. So that means a person can have a stone to lodge in one of their ureters. Not going to make a big difference if it's in the bladder, if it's just floating around in the bladder. But when it lodges in one of those ureters or it's in the kidneys, this is a person that's going to be in some pain. So the person may have some flank pain that's common. The person may have pain that radiates to the perineum when they have a stone lodged in the ureter. That pain can, again, radiate down to the perineum. They can complain of pain in the thighs, in the back. Now, if the person has a stone that lodges in the bladder neck, then, and if this is a man, then he'll complain of pain at the tip of his penis. Okay? So, some different causes for a person developing stones. Well, when we talk about decreased urine volumes, a person not taking in enough vitamin A or vitamin C, this can lead to a person developing stones as well. So there are a number of different procedures that can be done for a person with stones. Extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy is a procedure that can be done. It's a non-invasive procedure. With this type of procedure, the person, they're basically breaking the stone up with little shockwaves. Okay, and so even though they're breaking the stone up, they don't remove them. So the person still has to pass the stones. So when we have patients that are admitted with stones that are not being moved, they're not having an invasive procedure to remove them, then we have to strain this person's urine. And so we will put actual strainers in the little caps, in the little hats in the room. If it's a male and he's using a urinal, we're straining his urinal before we empty it out, when we're emptying it, because we want to determine when he's passed those stones. And he'll probably end up screaming, and so that'll kind of let you know that he's passed it. Your cystoscopic procedures that can be done. Laser lithotripsies, any type of lithotripsy procedure is going in to break up a stone. So, again, we got to make sure that we're draining the person's urine after the procedure. It makes sense that if these stones are not removed, that it can lead to further problems. I wish I could say once a person has a stone, they don't develop another one, but that would not be true. A lot of men or a lot of women that have stones will continue to develop stones. So, we just talked about lithotripsy. This uses a sound, a laser, or dry shock waves to break up the those stones into small pieces. The person is going to undergo some conscious sedation. We're going to continue to monitor the person's heart rate during this procedure. Bladder trauma can occur from injuries to the lower abdomen, definitely from a stabbing or a gunshot wound. That would make sense. And so usually surgical intervention is going to be required when a person has bladder trauma to occur. As it mentions in your book, fractures are going to be stabilized before the repair of the bladder can be performed. We remember that the bladder lies behind the symphysis pubis, and so that is bone in that area. So yeah, they're gonna wanna fix the fractures before repairing the bladder, so that those bone fractures don't affect the repair of the bladder itself. The book mentions different drains that the person may have in place after procedures of the bladder. The person may return after surgery with a Foley and possibly a Penrose drain. So just when we have the person with bladder trauma, we've got to make sure that we're continuing to monitor the person's urinary output. Once the repair is over, once the surgical procedure is over, if the person came in with anuria hematuria, we should not see those after the procedure. So after post-procedure, it's going to be important for the nurse to make sure that we're monitoring those drains. If the person comes back with a Penrose drain, we got to monitor the output from that drain. And we've also got to make sure that we're keeping up with the person's urinary output after a bladder trauma. We want to make sure that the bladder is not traumatized to the point where the person's urinary output has been affected. So we have to make sure that we're keeping up with that. Cool. So we already talked about a urethra stricture. Urethra is where urine leaves the urinary bladder. So if we have a urethra stricture, it makes sense then that that urine is not going to be able to appropriately leave the urinary bladder. Once the bladder is over-distended, the urine backs up into the ureters, and subsequently after the ureters, that fluid can back up into the kidneys. And so once it backs up into the kidneys, we have a condition that is referred to as hydronephrosis, or again, water inside of the kidney. If you remember, one of the first things I said when I talked about the renal pelvis, which is responsible for draining urine from the kidney itself to the ureters, the renal pelvis can hold about 3 to 5 mils of urine, and that's not a lot of urine. That's all it is designed to hold. And so when we have a person that develops this hydronephrosis, well, then you have all of this water that is backing up into the kidneys, and that is going to be a problem because we've probably already learned by now that it can lead to kidney damage. You see here on one of the pictures that we have a stone that's blocking one of the ureters, which is causing this person to develop some hydroureter. And so it can depend where the stone is lodged, where it affects. But definitely once a person develops hydroureter, it can progress to hydronephrosis. So any problems with the outflow of urine can lead to hydronephrosis, and subsequently your hydroureter, then hydronephrosis. And so the person with hydronephrosis can have a sudden onset of pain, and when we see that, that's probably related to a kidney stone. When the pain just hits them from out of nowhere, they've got some flank pain, intense pain, maybe complaining of pain in the hips, this could be related to a stone being lodged somewhere in the ureter. When we do blood tests on this person, it may show that the person has some impaired kidney function when it's hydronephrosis, some impaired kidney function, elevated urea and creatinine levels. The person may have some hyponatremia, maybe some metabolic acidosis going on. So, again, any condition that can affect urine output. Stones, blood clots, problems with the renal pelvis definitely could cause some hydronephrosis, because if the renal pelvis is where urine leaves to reach the ureters, well, if a person develops some stenosis or some hardening in the renal pelvis, then it's going to cause hydronephrosis to occur. And so the way that this is diagnosed, the person is going to need some ultrasounds to be done. Definitely already talked about blood tests that are going to be performed. This person is going to have some, ultrasound can be done, CT scans, MRIs, as far as doing any type of exams with contrast medium, that would probably not be done because the person is experiencing some problems with the kidneys at that point. Now, if it's only affecting one side, and usually it is, the person may be able to tolerate an intravenous pyelogram. So we're going to do those different types of studies or diagnostic exams to determine what's going on. Doppler studies, we're going to look at the vascular, do some vascular scans on the person as well. And so when we talk about the prognosis of a person that has hydronephrosis, it can be variable. I mean, if the person has one kidney versus both kidneys, well, then, yeah, one is definitely going to be better than both of them. Because, as we said, it can lead to some kidney damage. So once the person passes the stone, if it's a unilateral, if it's only one stone is affecting one side, then the likelihood is very good that the person is going to recover from this procedure. However, if this problem continues to go on, if it's a bilateral problem, bilateral hydronephrosis, the person can develop some problems, definitely some permanent kidney damage can occur as a result of that. Pyelonephritis is going to be when a person has infection. It says bacterial infection in the kidney and the renal pelvises. So inflammation of that kidney tissue, the calyces, the pelvis. Usually it's caused by bacterial infection that has spread up through the urinary tract. And so this is a person maybe with that bladder infection, and they never took care of it appropriately. This is a person with the bladder infection, and they didn't finish their course of antibiotics the way they were supposed to. They started feeling better, and so they just stopped taking the antibiotics. And so they didn't totally kill the bacteria. So pyelonephritis, again, can happen because of bacteria. It's commonly caused by bacteria that spread up the urinary tract and affects the kidneys. So when we have a person that has pyelonephritis, this person normally presents with, as it says here, fever, chills, an accelerated heart rate, some painful urination. They may have abdominal pain radiating to the back. So sounds like to me we're probably going to get an EKG on this person too, because we just want to make sure this person's not having some heart problems, some heart-related problems. They're going to complain about tenderness at the costovertebral area. So where is that area? How do we assess for costovertebral tenderness? I'll say back of your hand and fist. So think about health assessment and how we assess for costovertebral tenderness. Pyelonephritis that's progressed can cause signs of shock. The person can develop some rapid breathing, decreased blood pressure. When a person has pyelonephritis, they have to have some antibiotic therapy. The person may have to have some surgical procedures done to fix this. If the person needs maybe a nephrostomy to be performed, the person, if it's in a, there's a chronic rare form of pyelonephritis in which the person actually has to have the kidney removed, but that's a rare form of pyelonephritis. Some key features that we see, as it says here, with chronic pyelonephritis, the person having hypertension, inability to concentrate sodium, decreased concentrating ability. And one of the things that the person can develop is some delirium as a result of having pyelonephritis. So definitely a serious condition. The person can also develop hyperkalemia and acidosis, which kind of makes sense with the acidosis part, where the person is having some confusion, some acute confusion because of the pyelonephrosis. So when a person has signs and symptoms, when they have acute pyelonephritis, these symptoms can generally develop quite rapidly over a few hours or a day. As I said, the person's going to have some high fever, pain on passing urine. They're going to have some flank pain. They may also have some vomiting. Now, again, with the chronic type, the signs and symptoms are less severe. The person may have some signs of infection and fever. They may have urinary tract infections. They may have some hematuria also associated with the chronic form of pyelonephritis. And so when we do laboratory exams, we're going to do analysis on this person's urine. We're going to check for white blood cells. And it's the presence of white blood cells that is sufficient in helping to diagnose that this person has pyelonephritis. We can also do a complete blood count that may show that the person has some neutrophilia. We can do blood cultures as well. And also, when we talk about imaging studies, we can do a KUB, that kidney, ureter, bladder x-ray film on this person. We're going to do a non-contrast. We can do a non-contrast CT scan to determine if there are any detectable stones that may have been missed that caused this person to develop this pyelonephritis. So, how do we manage it? Well, we did a urine culture. So we're going to do a urine culture to determine what bacteria may have caused this so that we could get some antibiotics on board. And so for most cases of pyelonephritis, they're due to bacteria infections. And so antibiotics are going to be the mainstay of treatment for pyelonephritis. So your cephalosporins, aminoglycosides, these types of medications or antibiotics may be used. When you have patients that have a sensitivity to those types of medications, we can probably try ciprofloxacin on them, or levofloxacin may be utilized for these patients as well. We definitely want to make sure that the person is receiving adequate hydration, and so that's probably going to be most likely this person is going to require an IV for this. We want to make sure during the course of antibiotic treatment that the person, that we're monitoring the person's temp for any spikes in the temperature. And typically when a person comes in with pyelonephritis, they are going to be on IV antibiotics for at least the first 24 to 48 hours. And then we're going to transition them over to oral antibiotics, which may be taken for a total of 2 weeks. In your book, when you're reading on pyelonephritis, the book talks about several different types of procedures that can be done. So make sure that you read over those. Glomerulonephritis. Glomerular nephritis is, we remember that the glomerular, those are, they're in, you know, tiny little blood vessels that are in our kidneys, and it's, we're inside of the glomerulus where we have the filtering of blood and the removal of excess fluid. And so when we have damage to the glomerulus, then it makes sense then we're going to have problems with filtering and problems with removing fluid. And so glomerular nephritis is a serious illness and can be life-threatening if the person does not receive treatment for it. There are two different types of glomerular nephritis. We have acute, I'm just flipping through, make sure I have all of them. We have acute glomerular nephritis, and then we have the chronic type of glomerular nephritis. Now with our acute type of glomerular nephritis, this can start as a response to an infection such as strep throat or an abscess too. It can be caused by problems with the immune system overreacting to an infection. And so when it's this type, it can go away on its own without treatment, but if it does not go away, then the person is going to need to have immediate treatment to prevent long-term damage to their kidneys. And so illnesses that have been known to trigger glomerulonephritis, strep throat, lupus. There's a disease or disorder that's an autoimmune disease called good pasture syndrome. And this is a problem where the person has antibodies that attack the kidneys and the lungs. Also a person who uses ibuprofen a lot. When you're learning about different medications, some medications are nephrotoxic. And so ibuprofen, a person that uses NSAIDs on a regular basis is at risk for damaging their glomerulus. So what will we see on physical assessment of a person that has acute glomerulonephritis? Well, some of the early symptoms that we see, the person may have some puffiness in the face. They're not urinating as much. They're going to have blood in their urine, but not just blood. The urine is going to take on a dark rust color urine. And so kind of when we see blood tinged urine, it's just tinged. It takes on a pinkish color, but this is different. The blood is dark rust color. And so the person may have extra fluid in their lungs. So the person has a wet sounding cough, and then it affects the person's blood pressure as well. And so the way that this glomerulonephritis is going to be diagnosed, the first step is for the person to have a urinalysis done. And so I would think the change in that urine color is definitely going to send that person to the doctor. We're going to check a creatinine clearance. We're going to check protein levels in the person's urine. So again, make sure you go over those lab values. We're going to check urine specific gravity, check urine for red blood cells. Normally we should not have red blood cells in our urine. Okay, microscopic, small, very minute amounts may be seen sometime depending on what's going on with the person. We're going to check urine osmolality levels as well. We can also do some immunological testing if we think this person is having a problem with the immune system that's damaging the kidneys. Sometimes a person may have to have a kidney biopsy done to confirm the diagnosis to make sure that the person does not has not developed cancer as a result of this. So when we have a person that has glomerulonephritis, one of the things that can occur with this person is that it is going to cause the person's blood pressure to go up. So we have to fix that. We can't just ignore that because we got a kidney that's already sustained some damage because of bacteria. We don't want the kidney to sustain further damage because of the increased blood pressure and that increased blood flow that's coming to an already sick kidney. So we want to control the blood pressure. The doctor may order ACE inhibitors. We've learned that the kidneys, we don't know why, but kidneys respond well to ACE inhibitors. We learned that recently. ACE inhibitors will be good. The person may need corticosteroids if it's immune in nature. The person may need corticosteroids. Also, patients have had plasmapheresis treatments done before. Again, if it's something that's triggered by the immune system, the plasmapheresis can be done to help give that person some healthy antibodies. Give that person some plasma. When we talk about long-term and potential complications of glomerulonephritis, a person can develop some, definitely can develop some kidney damage as a result of this. Glomerulonephritis can lead to a situation or can lead to nephrotic syndrome. And we said the glomerulus is a part of the nephron. The nephron is the functional unit of the kidney. So glomerulonephritis can lead to nephrotic syndrome. So long term, we want to catch this early. if we catch the acute glomerulonephritis early, it can be temporary and it can be reversible. Okay. So, again, the way that we're going to control that acute form, what we said, we're going to give the person some antibiotics. Well, we're going to give the person some antihypertensive medications. The person may need corticosteroids. And the other thing, is still going to be important for the person to monitor their diet as well. So we kind of already talked about that. When we talk about dialysis, this is when the person, when we have that person with the acute phase and they're not responding to the treatments. They're not responding to the antihypertensives and the corticosteroids, and their urine output is not increasing. So when we talk about, we learned about people with acute kidney injury. Glomerulonephritis can lead to acute kidney injury. And so these people may have to have dialysis done, but we learned that with acute kidney injury, the person has problems for a couple of days and then it starts to resolve itself. Well, when we have a person that does not resolve itself, then they're going to require dialysis as a means of removing waste. When we talk about patient education, we said that some reasons that a person can develop glomerulonephritis, when we talk about things like strep throat, that's kind of one of those things, or a person having an abscess too, that we kind of don't want to ignore those things. And so whenever we're given, again, the importance of continuing your antibiotic regimen is going to be important here to make sure that we're getting rid of all the bacteria that they've given us the antibiotic for. Now with chronic glomerulonephritis, with the chronic form, this can develop over several years with or without symptoms. The person can have no symptoms or very few symptoms. When a person has this chronic form of glomerulonephritis, it can cause irreversible damage to the person's kidneys and lead to complete kidney failure. Sometimes with the chronic type of glomerulonephritis, it can be caused by genetic disease. The person can have some immune diseases that puts them at risk for developing chronic glomerulonephritis. If the person has a history of cancer, it can put them at risk for developing the chronic type of glomerulonephritis. And there's certain different types of solvents, exposure to different types of solvents in the environment, depending on where the person worked, that can put them at risk for developing this chronic type. So when a person has the chronic form of glomerulonephritis, as I said, the person may have no symptoms or have very few symptoms, but it can start to, once those symptoms start to materialize, the person may start to, the urine tests would show that the person has blood or protein in the urine. Again, this person can have high blood pressure, the swelling in the face and the ankles, frequent nighttime urination. Another thing, this person could have a bubbly or foamy urine, and this comes from that excess protein. Abdominal pain, nosebleeds, we can see any of that or a number of those symptoms when the person has the chronic type. So when we talk about assessments, again, ultrasounds can be done, CT scans can be done. The person may need a biopsy to be done as well. So, again, the person with the acute form, you know, they're kind of where they are in a better condition long term than the person with the chronic type of glomerulonephritis. So when we're talking in terms of diet for this person, with a chronic form of disease, it's going to be important for this person to reduce their protein, their salt, and their potassium. Remember, in that functional unit of the kidney, that's where the exchange of the sodium and the potassium took place, and we have our breakdown of proteins. Well, that part of the kidney is broken, so this person is going to need to reduce the amount of those. They're going to need to watch the amount of liquids that they drink. They may need calcium supplements. They may need to take diuretics on a routine basis to help reduce swelling. The person with chronic kidney disease is probably at some point going to need dialysis and eventually a kidney transplant, because with your chronic form of glomerulonephritis, it can lead to your end-stage renal disease. As I mentioned, your nephrotic syndrome. This person is going to continue to be at risk for electrolyte imbalances with sodium and potassium. They may have, they're going to be at risk for developing congestive heart failure due to the fluid overload, hypertensive problems, and we've already learned about hypertension, the other problems, and so you just have a vicious cycle that can happen here when a person has this chronic type of glomerulonephritis. Nephrotic syndrome, as it says here, is a condition of increased glomerular permeability. So something is coming through the glomerulus. Something's not being filtered. And so what's coming through the glomerulus are plasma proteins, causing the person to develop proteinuria. And when the person develops this proteinuria, it leads to a loss of plasma albumin, and it can lead to tissue edema. And so in a lot of patients that we see that develop nephrotic syndrome, we see it sometimes in people that also have diabetes, or again, the person that has lupus is at risk, can be at risk for developing this nephrotic syndrome. And so the characteristics, the manifestations that we usually see being associated with nephrotic syndrome, peripheral edema, the person has a massive proteinuria, hypertension, they may have some hyperlipidemia, some hypoalbuminemia. So what I want you to remember, think about why we need protein. Why is protein important for us? When we look at the person's blood chemistries, or when we draw labs on this person, they're going to have decreased serum albumin levels, decreased total protein, and elevated serum cholesterol levels. And so when we're dealing with the person that has nephrotic syndrome, this person is also going to have ascites and anasarca. And anasarca is a massive generalized edema. And so the reason that the person has this edema that develops is because they are losing protein. And so if you remember when we talked about the liver and we talked about the person losing protein, we talked about the osmotic pool that protein, the oncotic pool that proteins have. Well, this person is losing protein. And so we have fluid that builds up in the tissues and also in the person's abdomen. When a person has nephrotic syndrome, other things that can happen is that it affects the person's ability to clot as well, affect the person's clotting factors. And so in this situation, the person can develop or go into a hypercoagulable state, which means that the person's blood becomes too thick and it puts them at risk for developing thromboembolus. And so when we talk about the treatment for a person that has nephrotic syndrome, we can give the person immunosuppressants. I said that lupus is one of the conditions that we see being associated with nephrotic syndrome. Well, we consider lupus to be an autoimmune disease. And so in that situation, the person may need immunosuppressants. We said that the person has some hypertension, so ACE inhibitors are going to be good for that. For the hypercoagulability that the person has, we're going to need some heparin for that. And then we're going to have to make some dietary changes for this person. So we said that this person has some elevated cholesterol levels. So we definitely have to make sure that we have this person on a low cholesterol diet because of the hyperlipidemia that the person is experiencing. They may also need lipid-lowering agents because of the high cholesterol levels. I already talked about your the corticosteroids may be used because of the immunosuppression that the person the corticosteroids can be done as a result of the inflammation. We know that corticosteroids though can suppress the immune system, so we have to monitor this person for infection as well. This person, if they develop wounds, it makes sense that they're going to have some poor wound healing because of the fact that this person is losing protein, and we know that we need proteins to help with tissue rebuilding, and we also need protein to heal as well. So protein for this person, we're going to put this person on a moderate protein diet that is low in sodium. So the person may not like this diet. It may not be the most favorable diet, but this is how we are going to attempt to fix this situation. We're going to give the person mild diuretics. This is the person we're going to assess edema on a daily basis by doing daily weights. And so we're doing daily weights, we're recording intake and output, we're measuring abdominal girth. And again, we're going to do this on a daily basis. We have to make sure that we keep this edematous skin very clean, okay? Because when we talk about tissues, tissues building up in the skin, the skin is at risk of breaks, is very susceptible to breakdown when we have excessive fluid in them. But again, we have a person that's going to be in a state where if they develop wounds, well, then their ability to heal has been affected because of this protein loss. Nephrosclerosis is a problem that can occur when a person develops sclerosis or hardening or narrowing of the small arteries and arterioles of the kidney. And so when this happens, it makes sense that the person is going to have decreased blood flow that can lead to necrosis within the renal tissue. And so when this necrosis develops, it can lead to destruction of the glomerulus. And so what it says here is that nephrosclerosis can occur with all types of hypertension. Think about what happens with hypertension. We said that we have, the lumen of the blood vessels being affected because of the high pressures from the blood being pumped so forcefully, and so it affects the lumen of the vessels, causes them to become hardened or stiff. Blood sugar. Sugar causes the lumen of the vessels to become hardened. And so we see that with diabetes and atherosclerosis, we know that that's plaque buildup. So all of these things can affect blood flow throughout the body, but also inside of the kidney, inside of the nephron, affect blood flow and can affect the nephron, affect the functional units of our kidneys. And so when it talks about your collaborative management here, it said, well, For your collaborative management, we want to control blood pressure. We got to control the blood pressure and to preserve the kidney function that the person has. When we have this person, we want to make sure that we distinguish malignant nephrosclerosis from benign accelerated nephrosclerosis. So there are two types. So with your benign nephrosclerosis, we can see this develop in adults that are 30 to 50 years of age. And this is when this person may have vascular changes resulting from hypertension or from atherosclerosis. And so usually it's these atherosclerotic changes that are going to account for the loss of renal function. Now, with the accelerated nephrosclerosis, this is associated with malignant hypertension. And so with this type can happen in the young adult. And so when a person has this accelerated nephrosclerosis, then the person can develop renal insufficiency, and it usually progresses at a rapid rate. And so, again, the treatment for benign nephrosclerosis is going to be the same as treating hypertension. We want to make sure that the person is taking their high blood pressure medications on a regular basis, because we tend to see this as being the cause of this nephrosclerotic development. So we want to slow the damage to the kidneys. Renal vascular disease is it's a condition that's given to a variety of complications that can affect the arteries and the veins of the kidneys. And so when a person develops these complications, they affect blood circulation to the kidneys. And once that happens, then it makes sense that the person can have damage to the tissue of the kidneys, develop kidney failure as a result of that. So a condition, renal artery stenosis. The renal artery, how blood comes into the kidney, that artery becomes stenosed, becomes hardened. And so when this happens, this is a blockage of that artery. It may cause kidney failure. It's going to cause some hypertension. We see smokers being at a greater risk of developing renal artery stenosis. Renal artery thrombosis is another type of renal vascular disease. And so this is when a person has the formation of a clot inside of the renal artery. And so again, the thrombosis from this renal artery can lead to kidney failure because of the blocked blood flow. A person can have a renal artery aneurysm. And so when we talk about an aneurysm, that's a weakening or a bulging that happens within an artery. And so this one happens within the renal artery. And so renal artery aneurysms, they tend to be uncommon, but just know that they can occur. A person can have renal vein thrombosis, and so not the artery, but renal vein thrombosis. And so the renal vein has a clot, and so again, we're going to have blood flow that's going to be affected to the kidney itself. When we have a person, when we're talking about renal vascular disease, different things, there are different risk factors. Atherosclerosis definitely can be put a person at risk for developing one of these type of renal vascular diseases. Smoking, definitely hypercholesterol, diabetes, hypertension, the things that we typically see. Women can be at a greater risk of developing renal vascular diseases. So when we talk about the signs and symptoms of renal vascular disease, well, the thing about it is we have quite a few of them. I named like four different ones. So it depends on what type of problem the person is having. So we're going to go according to your book, and your book does not go into a lot of detail with the different types of renal artery disease. So it looks like we are going to discuss discuss the renal artery stenosis. And so when we do an assessment on this person, what we may see, it usually has a sudden onset before the age of 50. The person may have a history of atherosclerosis. The person may report that they have hypertension. that's not been responsive to medications. The person may have increased urea in their blood, unexplained kidney failure, or the person may have a sudden kidney failure that develops. And so this is what we can see when the person has this renal artery stenosis that develops. And so this can be diagnosed with arteriogram, ultrasounds can be performed, MRIs. And so the treatment for renal artery stenosis, antihypertensives are going to be important. ACE inhibitors are helpful to help treat the high blood pressure, definitely. If the person has a stenosis that's caused by atherosclerosis, then we're going to give them a statin or some type of medication to help lower the cholesterol. If the cause is because of diabetes, then we're going to treat the diabetes. The person may need surgical intervention, and so endovascular procedure such as an angioplasty, which is where they go in and open up that renal artery using a balloon, like kind of what we talked about with the cardiovascular system, they can have one of those procedures done. They may need placement of a stent to hold that renal artery open. And so this is how we can, this is a surgical intervention that can be performed for the person with renal vascular disease. Renal cell carcinoma or kidney cancer, we usually see this develop in the cortex or the pelvis of the kidney. It can occur anywhere in the kidney, but we tend to see it happen there. We see this adenocarcinoma. It happens twice as often. We usually see it happen more in men than in women. And it's typically one of those cancers that develops later in age, around 50 to 70 years of age. Cigarette smoking is the most significant risk factor that we see in the development of renal cell carcinoma. So other risk factors include obesity, hypertension, exposure to asbestos, exposure to gasoline. Okay, so a person is also at risk if they have chronic kidney diseases, and it can also be associated with people that are in end-stage renal disease. And so some of the clinical manifestations that we see when a person has renal cell carcinoma, if we think about all of the functions of the kidneys, all the ones that we've learned, and if the kidney is not able to do that anymore, well, then it makes sense that we're going to see the things that we see, see the signs and symptoms that we see listed on the screen. The most common presenting manifestation that the person will report is hematuria. Flank pain, and the person having a palpable mass in the flank area in the abdomen. So the person actually being able to palpate the kidney. Usually we're not able to palpate the kidneys. We can palpate the bottom pole of the kidney, but usually we're not able, to palpate the kidney. Usually, when we have people that have renal cell carcinoma, about 30% of patients that have it will have metastasis at the time of diagnosis. And so when renal cancer metastasizes, it moves to the renal vein and to the vena cava. So you have metastasis that can occur. It can go to the lungs, to the liver, and to the long bones as well. CT scan is what's commonly done to diagnose kidney cancer. And again, it's ultrasounds can be done, and we're going to do those different types of tests to help us determine if it's a solid mass or if it's a tumor. Angiography can be done. Aspiration can be done as well. When a person has a small renal tumor, if they're found early, the person usually has a better prognosis if it's caught early. And so when we have patients that have cancer, it's staged from 1 to 4. You know, 1 is limited to the kidney, and when we talk about 4, the person has the presence of metastasis. So nephrectomy is the performed. It can be performed by open approach or laparoscopically. And so the person may have to have a nephrectomy, removal of the kidney, the adrenal gland, the surrounding fascia, part of the ureter, and the draining lymph nodes. Radiation therapy can be used, and this is probably used palliatively when the person has inoperable cases and when the person has metastasis to the bone and lungs. Chemotherapy is used when a person has metastatic renal cell carcinoma. In your book, it talks about the post-procedural care of a person that has a nephrectomy. So again, make sure you read over that. Read over the monitoring of the person. It talks about monitoring the person for signs of hemorrhage. So again, make sure you read over that. Read over managing pain and the prevention of complications when a person has renal cell carcinoma. Kidney trauma can occur from minor injuries, contusions, or lacerations. A person can have major injuries to the kidney that causes lacerations to the cortex, the medulla, to the branches of the renal artery. We tend to see the majority of incidents of renal trauma occurring in men that are older, that are younger than 30 years of age. Blunt trauma is the most common cause that we see for renal trauma, and we see this, you know, due to sports injuries, traffic accidents, falls. And so the person is likely to sustain this injury when they have injuries to the abdomen and to the back. The person can sustain damage to the kidney as a result of injuries to these areas. Also, penetrating injuries from gunshot wounds or stabbings can cause definitely damage to the kidneys if these areas are affected. And so the clinical findings that we may see the person, if it's, you know, definitely directly affecting the kidney, then the person is going to have some hematuria, may have some gross or microscopic hematuria. We're going to do some diagnostic studies. We're going to do some urinalysis on the person. We may have to do a cystography and some ultrasound to determine the areas of damage. The person may also need a renal arteriogram to determine if there any if there's been damage sustained to the renal arteries. And the severity of the renal trauma or the kidney trauma depends on the extent of the injury. With the treatment, treatment can range from bed rest, fluids, and analgesia to the person needing surgical repair, or a partial or total nephrectomy. So it depends on how extensive the surgery, how extensive the damages or how extensive the injury is. And so when we look at nursing interventions, again, it's going to vary with the type of renal trauma that the person has sustained. We definitely want to make sure that we assess the person's cardiovascular status. If the person had a penetrating injury, we want to monitor them for signs of shock as a result of blood loss. We want to ensure that the person has adequate fluid intake. It makes sense that we want to monitor the person's intake and output because we want to know if this injury is affecting the person's renal function. We're going to continue to assess this person for hematuria. And then we've got to potentially monitor this person for nephrotoxic antibiotics. And so what's going to be important in teaching this person, before this person is discharged, they have to be really careful with the type of medications that they receive. And some medications and some over-the-counter preparations that we take, as we said, like your pain relievers, some of your antibiotics can be nephrotoxic. And so they have to be knowledgeable of that and know to ask about the side effects of the medications that they're going to be taking. Okay, so now we're going to move to our peds portion, and we'll begin with acute glomerulonephritis. So when you're reading in your book, you'll notice that when it starts to talk about acute glomerulonephritis, it says that it includes a number of distinct entities. With a glomerulonephritis, it's the most common inflammation of the glomerulus that occurs with children. But we tend to see this happen most often when children have had some type of strep infection. So any type of strep infection that's affected the skin or the pharynx, we tend to see this being highest in children between the ages of 2 to 6. And the disorder is more common in boys than in girls. And so what can typically happen that causes a child to develop this acute glomerulonephritis is after a child has become ill with a strep infection, like upper respiratory strep, or again, you know, we can develop strep infections of the skin, so strep throat. It can happen in an interval of 10 to 21 days after a child has had an active strep infection. And what can happen when the child develops this glomerulonephritis? It affects the capillary bed, the capillaries in the glomerulus. And so once they become obstructed, it leads to a damage of tissue, and then the child has a decreased glomerular filtration rate. The child is also going to have decreased vascular permeability, which means that blood is not going to flow through those blood vessels, through those veins and arteries the way that it once did. And then the child will also have problems with sodium and water retention. So some of the clinical manifestations that we'll see with the child with this, with the vascular permeability, I said that it decreased, I meant that it increases. Sorry about that. With the clinical manifestations, usually we see a number of children that are going to be asymptomatic. Other children, when they have the onset of glomerulonephritis, is usually going to be an abrupt onset, with the child having flank pain, mid-abdominal pain, irritability, malaise, fever. The child may have some microscopic hematuria. If it continues to progress, that microscopic hematuria can become gross hematuria and result in tea-colored urine. And this can be found in up to half of the cases. The child may develop some periorbital edema in the feet and the ankles. The child could also develop some pulmonary effusions that's going to cause some cough and some crackles and some ascites. And so another thing that we can see with them, they can develop some hypertension that occurs, but that's a problem with them because when they develop this hypertension, it can lead to encephalopathy, leading to headaches, nausea and vomiting, lethargy and seizures. And the child may or may not have a decrease in urine output. So with our clinical therapy, we're going to assess a BUN and creatinine. Both of them are going to be elevated. The serum protein may be decreased as a result of the proteinuria. And so the lipid levels on this child, they're going to be increased as well. The child may still have elevated strep levels, so that means that whatever antibiotic they were given did not totally clear that strep. So we're going to check for strep antibodies as well. We're going to do a urinalysis. The urinalysis, again, is going to reveal hematuria, some proteinuria, some red blood cells and white blood cells. Because I said that vascular permeability is going to increase. So then it's going to allow more red blood cells to be excreted. So, yeah, the child's going to have some hematuria. Anemia is a late sign that we'll see with the child, and it's a result of that hematuria that's taking place. And so when we talk about treatment, treatment focuses on the relief of symptoms and is usually supportive in nature. This child, bed rest is going to be important. When we talk about the edema and the hypertension, is going to be treated with sodium restrictions and diuretics. And the diuretics, such maybe given such as furosemide. If we're in an emergent situation and the child has some severe hypertension and some cerebral dysfunction, then we may need a hydralazine to be used intravenously. We're going to give the child a course of antibiotics to ensure that we have a complete eradication of that infectious agent. And so the prognosis for children is it's pretty good. It's 90%. Now we'll move on to nephrotic syndrome. And nephrotic syndrome kind of looks a little bit like what we see with the adult. We see problems with protein, with the plasma proteins with nephrotic syndrome. Basically, a problem occurs with the glomerulus. The glomerulus stops working properly, and then it allows too much protein to enter the kidneys. And so we tend to see this happen in kids, you know, usually younger than the age of 5. And when we talk about some of the causes of of nephrotic syndrome, different types of problems, like anything, problems that affect the kidneys, immune system problems, infections, diabetes, children that have diabetes, an allergic reaction to food, bee stings, certain type of drugs. Children that are morbidly obese for their age can develop nephrotic syndrome. Some kids may have no obvious symptoms until they're diagnosed with a urine test. And other kids, when the symptoms do appear, it's usually in the form of swelling and weight gain. This tends to be more common. And so the common places that we see for swelling are in the face, around the eyes, in the abdomen, in the legs, in the arms and legs, particularly around the ankles and the feet. And so some kids with nephrotic syndrome, they'll start to notice the swelling in their ankles after they've been sitting for a long period of time. Other signs that a mom or dad may see when the child has nephrotic syndrome, they may report that the child had a loss of appetite, some diarrhea, less frequent urination, and then the urine taking on that dark foamy color. Remember, we said that foam came from that extra protein. And so in rare cases, the child can develop other symptoms and complications such as kidney damage or kidney failure if we do not treat the nephrotic syndrome. And so the way that the doctor is going to diagnose this, they're going to do some urine samples to check for protein. They may also do some blood sampling as well. The test can help determine if the child has nephrotic syndrome. They may also do a kidney biopsy to help determine if it is nephrotic syndrome. And so usually nephrotic syndrome is treatable, but it's going to depend on the cause. As I said, it can be autoimmune in nature. It can be because of an allergic reaction. There are a number of different, it can be because of obesity. So there can be a number of reasons that a child develops nephrotic syndrome. And so when we talk about, again, treatment of the child, we've got to fix a number of things. The child is going to come in, probably with some electrolyte problems, some hypoalbuminemia. The protein levels are going to be low. They may have some hematuria, so we have to assess for anemia. We have to assess blood pressure, because these children are going to come in. Some of them are hospitalized with severe edema. So corticosteroids, usually a prednisone is going to be prescribed to decrease the protein urea. And most children, the urine protein level falls, to trace levels within 2 to 3 weeks after the start of prednisone therapy. And so the medication, whenever we have patients, anybody, grown, child, any age, whenever a person is taking corticosteroids, we have to taper them off of the medication. Then it's done the same way with the child. The medication is going to be tapered and discontinued over a 2 to 3 month period. If the child's not responding to those oral corticosteroids, then the child may receive IV methylprednisone. When the child receives IV methylprednisone, the child is going to be monitored. We're going to also monitor blood sugars, and we kind of remember that. When we give a child an albumin infusion, we follow the albumin infusion with furosemide, and this is done to help treat massive edema in the children who've been unresponsive to fluid restrictions and diuretics. So we're going to give them an albumin infusion and then furosemide. So think about it, and think back to our GI lecture. Why would we give the plasma infusion followed by the furosemide? So for my studious people, kind of email me that answer. We're going to give analgesics for pain that they may experience because of the edema or the flank pain. Some children can have relapses of nephrotic syndrome. That happens in up to 50% of the children. Other medications that can be used, we already talked about diuretics. We may also use antihypertensives. Some children develop infections with this as well, so they may need antibiotics. So when we're dealing with the children, we're always going to provide education for the parents as well. This is always important. We're going to, while they're hospitalized, again, we're monitoring hypertension, hyperglycemia because of the steroids. Again, making sure that the families know not to abruptly discontinue the corticosteroids. If the child is receiving albumin intravenously, we want to monitor them closely for signs of hypertension and fluid overload. If we remember, when we give a person albumin, albumin is going to cause a fluid shift. So just think about it. So when we have children with nephrotic syndrome, they're going to be at a greater risk for infection. It's going to be for two reasons, because they're losing immunoglobulins in the urine, and then because of the corticosteroid therapy. So we've got to implement careful hand washing, our standard precautions, strict aseptic technique when dealing with them. We got to continue to monitor the white blood cell counts, continue to monitor the vital signs, making sure we pay attention to definitely that temperature. And so we want to discuss with parents the importance of having influenza immunizations, and then they need to avoid people who have who've been vaccinated with live viruses. So when the child is discharged, and it's important that the family knows the importance of hand washing and avoiding helping the child to avoid developing infections. Wilms tumor is also referred to as nephroblastoma. This is an intrarenal tumor. and it is a common abdominal tumor of childhood, and it accounts for about 6% of all childhood tumors. It occurs frequently between when the child is around 41 to 47 months of age. Wilms tumor is associated with several congenital anomalies. There's a condition known as hemihypertrophy. There are some genital urinary anomalies. So there are some different types of congenital problems that put a child at risk for developing Wilms tumor. There's a genetic link between some different chromosome deletions, and we won't go into that. Outside of that, you have some children that develop Wilms tumor that have no other abnormalities. They have no congenital anomalies. They have no genetic predisposition. They just develop the tumors for whatever reason, much like with other types of cancers. Some people just develop these type of cancers. The thing about Wilms tumor is that it grows very quickly. It doubles in size in 11 to 13 days. It has such a fast growth that it generally contributes to being quite a large tumor at the time of diagnosis. Chemotherapy drugs have increased survival rates of children with Wilms tumor to 90%. And so, usually when a child has Wilms tumor, they're asymptomatic. They have a firm lobule mass that's located on one side of the midline of the abdomen. And often, you know, the parent discovers the mass during a bath. Hypertension caused by increased renal activity related to renal damage is reported in 25% of the cases. Hematuria and abdominal pain is sometimes present as well. And so the therapy, the diagnosis of Wilms tumor is usually done with an ultrasound study of the abdomen. The child may also have an IVP done, an intravenous pyelogram. CT scans, MRIs of the lungs, liver, and spleen can be done to determine if there's any metastasis that has taken place. Again, this information can be done to determine the staging of the tumor. Complete blood counts can be performed, as well as BUN and creatinine levels to determine if there's kidney problems that have developed. Treatment is going to be multifaceted. Surgery is going to be performed to remove the affected kidney. They're going to examine the other kidney to look for metastasis. Chemotherapy or radiation therapy may be done alone or in combination. And sometimes you'll have before surgery, the child, they may elect to do radiation before surgery. Children whose tumors are almost completely excised, they have a favorable prognosis and usually may not require radiation. So long-term complications of Wilms tumor include liver damage, portal hypertension, mild cirrhosis. The child may have sustained damage from the radiation if they have radiation, and so the radiation damage could lead to weakening the skeletal system, weakening the pelvis and the thorax has been reported. Kyphosis develops as a result of the radiation. Scoliosis can also occur. The child can also develop some glomerular damage to the remaining kidney as a result of the treatment for it. Secondary malignancies can occur as a result of the radiation that the child sustained in treating Wilms tumor. And so when we talk about nursing management of this child, we have the post-renal surgical phase and then the chemotherapy phase. And we've already talked about chemotherapy treatment in children. So we just want to make sure that we're monitoring the child's blood counts, the white blood cell count, the platelets, the red blood cells, monitoring intake and output. We're doing daily weights on this child. We're going to monitor urine-specific gravity because we want to monitor the function of the remaining kidney. We're going to make sure that we're monitoring the blood pressure to watch for signs of shock that may occur after the procedure, after that kidney has been removed. During the chemotherapy phase, again, we're monitoring them for the side effects of chemotherapy, and we've talked about all of those things. And so, ideally, our desired outcome for the child with Wilms tumor is that, you know, they have normal vital signs, recovery from surgery, and successful management with their remaining kidney. One practice note that I want to add, if you're a practitioner or a mom or auntie or, you know, anyone, if you feel a mass during palpation of a child's abdomen, you want to stop palpating immediately and then report that to the child's primary care physician. We never palpate the liver or abdomen of a child with Wilms tumor because this could cause a piece of the tumor to dislodge. And we want to place, when we working with a child that has Wilms tumor, we want to place a sign over the child's bed alerting other healthcare providers not to palpate the abdomen. Polycystic kidney disease. This is a genetic disorder. The person that has polycystic kidney disease, we see this in 1 in 20,000 live births. It's a cellular hyperplasia, and the cellular hyperplasia happens within the collecting ducts of the kidneys and causes dilation of the ducts. So when this happens, fluid is secreted into the ducts and enables cyst sacs to form inside of the within the kidneys. So initially, these cysts are small and don't obstruct urinary flow. As the child continues to grow, the cysts become larger, and then fibrosis begins to occur within the kidney. So as these cysts grow, they're going to replace much of the kidney's mass and reduce the kidney's function. And so what can happen as a result of that is that the child develops a tubular atrophy. And so the tubes start to shrink, and then it's going to decrease the renal function. And so when a person has polycystic kidney disease, it's also associated with some liver abnormalities. The child can develop some portal hypertension. We sometimes see newborns with autosomal recessive PKD or polycystic kidney disease having enlarged kidneys that are detected at birth. And so those with the most severe form of polycystic kidney disease die shortly after birth from pulmonary complications. So the clinical manifestations that we see when children have this polycystic kidney disease, they have hypertension that develops early in infancy and it's often severe. The child or the infant may experience oliguria. They may have urine output, or they may have oliguria that develops. Respiratory distress, feeding intolerance may develop from the enlarged kidneys. Uremia can develop, and we know that uremia is when waste can't be eliminated from through the bladder, through the urethra, and so those waste products come out through the skin. So the child develops uremia. They may have developed problems with the bones as well because of chronic hyperparathyroidism. So problems with calcium, and so calcium leaving the bones. And so renal biopsy or sonogram is going to confirm diagnosis. Liver function tests are going to be performed. The liver biopsy may also be done as well. And so with these children, treatment is usually going to be supportive in nature. Diuretics are going to be prescribed for hypertension. Fluid and electrolyte abnormalities, we're going to manage those. Antibiotics are going to be given to treat any urinary tract infections. Growth hormones may be used for children to promote growth. Many children that have this disease are going to develop end-stage renal disease by the age of 10. So this means that child is going to need renal dialysis or a transplant to prolong survival. However, the liver problems that the child develops as a result of the polycystic kidney disease are going to complicate the complicate their health even when the renal condition is well controlled. And so when we talk about nursing care for a child with polycystic kidney disease, it's going to be similar to that of a child with renal insufficiency or chronic renal failure. We want to make sure that the child, that the family knows to follow up with appointments, make sure that the child has a diet that's adequate in protein and in calories to help support growth. And we want to monitor the child for acute GI illnesses that can be that can increase stressors on the system. Monitoring the child for progressive renal insufficiency, and so this child is probably going to come in on a regular basis to have their glomerular filtration rates checked. Since the child, since this is an inherited disease, the family should be referred for genetic counseling.